Welcome to the fourth lecture in our series of lectures commemorating the 40th anniversary of the American Science Center, a series in which we've asked our faculty members to present to us their most interesting and important recent research. And today we have the pleasure of hosting Dr. Tomasz Basiuk, whom we all know. Dr. Basiuk has a doctoral degree in English from the University of Warsaw in 1997 and a habilitacja in literature from the University of Gdańsk in 2014. His most important research topics are contemporary American fiction, film and life, writing, critical theory, and queer studies. He published a lot about contemporary American gay men life, writing, and queer culture in general. His most important publications in 2013, Exposures, American Gay Men's Life Writings in Stonewall, a previous monograph, I'll just translate it to English, The Great Goddess, Postmodernist Realist in 2003, editor and co-editor of several volumes and brief studies in the Arab American Studies Journal, Queer Mixture in 2002, and Parameters of Desire 2006, Out of Here 2006, and American Jews of History 2011. Also guest editor of an issue of Dialogue and Universalism on the theme of gender and sexuality in 2010. In 2006, he co-founded and served on the editorial board of an electronic queer studies journal, Inter Alia. Of course, teacher here at us at the American Studies Center. He was a former director of the center since 2005-2012. So he's my director. And you don't remember him as probably, I still do. Among a variety of courses that he teaches here, I want to mention one, which is Transatlantic Symposium, which is a very interesting research project which we have with University of Humboldt University in Germany and Oregon State, which is a course which you can take, and some of you may go to a trip and a conference to Germany or America. It's a very interesting thing. He was a Fulbright scholar at the CUNY Graduate Center in 2004 and 2005. Also many other places that he was at, for example, Indiana University, but I'll not mention all of them. And also, very recently, he became head of the Polish team in a research grant which he got the International Consortium from the European Union, HERA project, the Humanities in the European Research Area. Among others, leading partner in this grant at the University of Edinburgh. So very prestigious, very interesting, and very important thing. And please join me in welcoming Dr. Basiuk.
Thank you very much for this kind introduction. Maybe before I start giving the talk, I'll just briefly add to the point which Mr. Piotr Szyjak has made about the Transatlantic Symposium. Because the symposium, it used to be that there was a pre-departure seminar, which was a course, and I think this may change a little bit, but the whole point is that it's open to master's students, I think probably only to students in the advanced track, although we'll see what happens next year. And it's a student research project, which culminates in a student conference, an international student conference, with the universities which Mr. Shia mentioned, the Humboldt at Oregon State, and it alternates, it takes place every year, but it alternates between the US and Europe, so that one year it's in the US and then the next year it's in Europe. And so we've just come back, for students from this department and I, we just came back from a trip to Southern California and Oregon, and which was at the end of March, and the next such event will be in March 2017, and that will probably be, it will be in Europe, and it will probably be in Croatia and in Berlin, okay? So someplace in Croatia and then Berlin. We'll be traveling between Croatia and Berlin for about 10 days, probably spending like a 5-6 day period in Croatia and then about 3-4 days in Berlin. So there'll be more information. I don't have more information at this point to share, but I just want to bring it up and also recommend to those of you who may be interested. So what this is a talk that I've actually been working on for almost a decade now, but it's never become a kind of major part of what I was doing, and it's something that I've been sort of developing slowly. I gave this talk I gave a version of this talk at the conference about a decade, I think about 8 or 9 years ago. And then I wrote a paper about 3 years ago, which was based on that talk. And last year I was invited to the University of Lausanne in Switzerland, and I was giving a public lecture, and essentially the public lecture will be the talk today also, the same talk more or less. So it's something that I'm hoping to kind of develop into a bigger thing, a larger essay, possibly, you know, part of the book, but that is still kind of work in progress. And it's not been my, you know, doctoral research or my habilitatio project, it's just a kind of marginal thing that I've been doing, but I find it interesting, and it's to do with film. And so here is the kind of alternative title of the talk. It's almost the same as the one I advertised, except that the words poetics of embodiment are in this title. And another term that I've kind of toyed with in my mind here is heroics of embodiment, as opposed to poetics. I think I'll probably stick with poetics. So the whole idea, I just have one slide to share, and then I'll be showing some excerpts from the films as I move along. I'm going to be speaking about four films. Okay, those are the four films. And my point is that, you know, I guess, who Jonathan Demme is, right? And you've probably seen Silence of the Lambs at some point. And possibly also Philadelphia. Pedro Almodóvar, again, I hope and think that probably the name is familiar to some of you. He's a well-known Spanish filmmaker. And I'm going to be focusing on two of his films and also two films by Demme. And so my whole point is that, that I think that when Pedro Almodóvar made Law of Desire in 1987, that film became a kind of important film for some US filmmakers, and some of them you would kind of maybe think of right away, and those would be people that are connected to the so-called new queer cinema movement, people like Greg Araki, for example. But one unlikely figure that also, I think, has been influenced by this film and kind of used this film, quoted this film in a way, or alluded to this film in a way, in other words, pay homage to Almodóvar's Law of Desire, is Jonathan Demme, and he did this in Philadelphia in 1993. So what I'm saying is here is that is that Philadelphia kind of pays homage to Law of Desire. But then what happened next, I think, is that Pedro Almodóvar kind of realized that Demme has done this, that Demme has kind of alluded to an Almodóvar film. And in one of his later films, he responded to this gesture. He reciprocated the gesture by paying homage to Demme, okay, by kind of answering Demme. And this happens in a relatively recent film called The Skin I Live In, which is kind of a response to Demme's The Silence of the Lambs. Okay, that's really what I'll be saying. And as I do this, I'll be talking about the differences in the way that they treat what I'm trying to call poetics or heroics of embodiment. And just for the sake of clarity, I'm going to simply follow the chronological order. So I'll talk about those four films in this sequence, okay? I'm not going to be starting with homage, but rather just kind of describe the four films in the chronological order as they appear here. So, what I want to say lies at the core of this cinematic dialogue are the two directors' distinctive approaches to what I'm calling poetics or heroics of embodiment. I mean by this term the ways in which filmic characters are constructed as embodying certain topical ideas that the films put forth. In most general terms, while both directors use their characters as symbols standing for particular attitudes and values, coping strategies, identity positions, and lifestyle choices, Demme's character's development illustrates either progressive self-integration through self-empowerment or a fall into disintegration through object disempowerment. Demme's use of characters thus seems to reflect a stereotypically American ideological preference for the self-made individual. At the same time, individualism is constantly undermined with conformism, or the idea of conformism. By contrast, Almodóvar's use of characters does not presuppose individuated autonomy on terms comparable to those manifest in Demme. Almodóvar's characters are driven by impulses and desires that originate from the outside and that are relational. Although both directors draw on psychoanalysis, Almodóvar's inspiration is directly Lacanian and profoundly constructionist. His characters are portrayed as being at the mercy of forces larger than themselves, and their attempts to take control of their lives are always frustrated. Almodóvar seems especially intent on tearing down the concept of the autonomous, self-made individual. And I'm going to illustrate this by speaking at first about the law of desire and the science of the lamps, films which are not yet constructed by the dialogue between the two filmmakers. So, skipping parts so as not to take too much time. So I'm going to now play you this closing sequence of Law of Desire. I hope this can be successfully accomplished here. Just make sure I get to the right place. And I'm not going to turn the sound on just yet, because I would like to kind of use this as background for what I'll be saying. Okay. Watch the images if you like, and I'll be kind of explaining what is going on as we go along. I'm not very good in technology, so sorry about this. Can you see that? I mean, is this good enough? So the closing sequence of Love Desire simultaneously presents and subverts the logic of romantic love, which Antonio, who is played by Banderas, embraces by mouthing the lyrics of the tango about the purest love, as if those lyrics were about him. And so maybe I'll stop here and just very briefly say that the film features a filmmaker whose name is Pablo. Pablo is in love with Juan, but Antonio Banderas, whose character is also called Antonio, falls in love with the filmmaker Pablo. And out of jealousy, at one point, kills Juan. Okay, this is kind of a tragedy in itself. And there's a series of developments where Pablo realizes what has happened. He kind of turns away from Antonio, runs away from him in a sense, has a car accident, loses his memory, and has a kind of moment in which he meets with his sister again. His sister is transgender, so his sister used to be his brother, but now is a sister. And what the sister tells Pablo is that she has become transgender in order to satisfy their father, who was basically sexually molesting the son. Okay, and yet the father was not homosexual, and so the son decided to become a woman in order to sort of please the father. This is the narrative that we get. So there is this very strange kind of family secret that is revealed in this moment. And also, remember, Pablo has lost his memory as a result of the car accident. And so what is happening also is that the sister, whose name is Tina, is kind of reprogramming that family, that memory, kind of giving him an alternative, you know, family story, one that he did not know. We have that happen, the sister is a single mother, actually. There's a complicated reason why she has a daughter, whose name is Ada. But in any case, she's a single mother, and she's always kind of looking for a lover. Antonio, who wants to come back to Pablo, pretends to fall in love with Tina, okay? And he kind of misleads her, seduces her, in order to get close to Pablo again. Pablo, remember, has turned away from him because he knows that Antonio has killed Juan. And this culminates in a kind of confrontation at the very end of the film, where Antonio is exposed and he's about to be arrested, but he has kidnapped Tina, and he demands that the police give him an hour alone with Pablo, and that Pablo also come up to the apartment. He will release Tina and her daughter Ada in return, but he needs this one final hour with Pablo. Okay, and so this is what the sequence is portraying. This is the last scene of the film. And so, once again, this sequence presents and subverts the logic of romantic love, which Antonio embraces. He does this by mouthing the lyrics of a tango about the purest love, as if those lyrics were about him. Those words are, you could not find a purer love than my love for you. The scene suggests that the consummation of this kind of love is tantamount to death, or that the price for this love, this kind of love, is death. The figure of equivalence between love and death is readable in two ways. In Lacanian terms, it represents an illusion, characteristic of the imaginary order, that the movement of desire, the illusion that the movement of desire can find its resting place. But in the context of the 1980s AIDS epidemic, it seems to address the particular link between homosexuality and death. Notably, this equivalence was already in play, this first equivalence was already in play in Almodóvar's previous film from 1986 called Matador, in which there are two lovers who long to die together in an act of love. And they're both heterosexual, a man and a woman, and they keep on essentially just killing people, whom they seduce. But they don't find satisfaction in those killings and those acts of love until they meet each other, and they can have this perfect moment when they kill one another, not from a position of someone who kind of stealthily steals this kind of love from someone that they are murdering, but they know what they are doing. And so in Matador, Almodóvar has kind of presented heterosexual love, which is kind of strange love because it's connected to death. But his point, I think, is that romantic love has a kind of relationship to death. And now he's doing a similar kind of story about homosexual love, and he's doing this in an era when AIDS is a very important social phenomenon and medical phenomenon. And this moment dictates the logic that homosexual love is connected to death. It leads to death. It's a logic which precedes the era of AIDS, because, for example, homosexuality stereotypically is infertile, and so it gets kind of connotes death rather than life for that reason. But of course, the epidemic of HIV/AIDS has amplified this logic. And so I'm trying to argue that the Law of Desire is a film which kind of addresses this connection, this cultural link, this phantasmatic link between homosexuality and death, and that this is actually the reason why new queer cinema also became interested in Almodóvar. But what I want to talk about in a minute, of course, is how Demme uses this idea. So I'm just going to continue for a moment talking about this film. So while Law of Desire makes only the most passing reference to AIDS, there's only one moment in which AIDS is mentioned. It's a moment in which Antonio asks Pablo if they're going to be having safe sex or not. The similar treatment of the relationship between passionate romantic love and death in Matador and in Law of Desire suggests that Almodóvar is resisting any special link, any particular link between homosexuality and death, as opposed to heterosexuality and death. In terms of a Lacanian notion of desire, although Pablo's Pieta-like embrace of Antonio at the end, you've just seen this, against the background of candles burning on an altar, puts forth the equivalence between love and grief, suggesting that desire has ceased in the consummate work of mourning. We remember that Antonio has just moved beyond his grief for Juan and has knowingly had sex with Juan's murderer. The scene of Pablo's Pieta-like mourning is interrupted when the candles on the altar seem to flare up, while onlookers gathered in the street outside climb up the fire escapes. This sequence is stopped with a freeze frame, as if to suggest that stoppage, including stoppage of desire, is an artificial device, as is the equivalence between love and death. So to reiterate this point in perhaps simpler words, what I'm trying to say is that this film presents desire in a Lacanian way, which means that desire is never reciprocated and never fulfilled. Okay, so, for example, Pablo falls in love with Juan, but Antonio falls in love with Pablo. Okay, so you don't have two people in love with each other, but you have a kind of triangle of love. And also, the moment in which this happens at the end of the film. The moment in which we have Pablo kind of seemingly reconciled with Antonio. Is one of a number of moments in this film in which something like like a break or a stoppage in the movement of desire is suggested, but none of those moments is final. Okay? Every one of those moments is just a repetition of the previous moment. Does this make sense to you? Do you see what I'm trying to say? So this film kind of seems to present the idea of romantic love, but in a sense it also subverts this idea of romantic love by using this psychoanalytic way of looking at love as something that can never be fulfilled, which is what I use the word Lacanian to describe this effect. I'm not reading everything because I don't want to bore you to death, but I'll just need to say a few other things. So I'm also going to maybe ask you to look at the very beginning of this film, which is actually what we are saying now. Again, I'll do the same, I'll just kind of describe what is happening here. So in this scene, which you will begin to view in a moment, maybe I can speed it up a little bit. You see a young actor who is instructed by one of two middle-aged men, both of whom remain standing behind a lectern and do not approach the young man, to kiss his reflection in a mirror and to rub his crotch against it, as the other man is dubbing the young man's voice. So essentially what we see is a scene in which people seem to be making a porn film, and this film, as we find out while we are watching Law of Desire, is actually a film by Pablo, by the filmmaker Pablo, okay, who is the protagonist of this film, of Almodóvar's film. So the actor is then told to lie face down and to repeatedly say, fuck me, and his voice is being dubbed. So he does this after being assured that he would not be touched. He's also repeatedly told not to look at the camera, and he's supposed to, you know, masturbate with orgasm. Once he appears to come, which we do not actually see, the two middle-aged men seem very pleased, though it is unclear if they're pleased because the scene has worked well or if they're pleased in a kind of erotic sense. The young actor is then given a bundle of cash, he's given money, and this of course is a kind of reference to the industry term money shot, which is the term for, you know, for the shot of ejaculation, probably for the reason that actors would be paid on the basis of, you know, having accomplished this feat. And so what I'm trying to say about this scene in my paper is that it kind of plays again with this idea of desire not being fulfilled. Desire is kind of translated into symbolic terms. We have an actor who is standing in front of a mirror, kind of narcissistically admiring himself, and this is like Lacan's mirror stage, which is the beginning of narcissism and the beginning of the imaginary mirror. And then we also have a voiceover. We have a director who is telling the actor what to do, and then another actor, an elderly man, who is giving him, lending him his voice by dubbing the actor's words, and the actor is just saying "fuck me, fuck me," and so there is a kind of disjunction between the image and the voice, and what I think Almodóvar is doing here is kind of tearing apart this idea of heroics of embodiment or poetics of embodiment. They're trying to suggest that we are constructed as, you know, as beings. We are constructed as through what Lacan calls partial objects of desire. Okay, so we have forces of desire and forces of language acting upon us in a way that kind of interrupts the idea or questions the idea that we are well-integrated beings. Okay, this is, in very simple terms, this is the point I'm trying to make, and I think that the beginning sequence, the opening sequence of this film, already very clearly introduces us to this idea. So, I'm going to also tell you what happens next. What happens after this sequence, which you'll see in a moment again, is that we are introduced to the character of Antonio, played by Antonio Banderas, and Antonio is Antonio, who, you know, later falls in love with Pablo to the point where he murders Juan and kidnaps, you know, Antonio basically, and dies as a result of all this. Antonio here falls in love with Pablo because he's seeing this film, and what happens is that he begins to imitate the gestures of this very scene. Okay, he will see this in a few minutes, but he goes down into the basement and goes into a latrine and he begins to masturbate to the memory of that scene and an imitation of that scene. So the idea again is that love and desire is not something that is kind of coming from the person in some kind of spiritual or internalized way, but rather it's something that is imposed from the outside. It's something that is relational. It's something that is based on images and voices that surround us, and that's the origin of desire and love. Okay, so this is my argument about love, desire, very, very briefly. In the final scene, the scene which I played at the beginning, the very important moment to me is when, once again, when Antonio begins to kind of dance with Pablo. Pablo's leg is in a cast because he's been in the car accident, he cannot walk properly, but Antonio tries to dance with him, and he lip-syncs, essentially, the words about pure love to Antonio. Once again, he doesn't, the logic of love, the words of love, the justification of love and the expression of love, they do not come from within the person, but they are essentially or literally being played, you know, on a recording device, and he's just lip-syncing those words. Okay, that's what I want to emphasize about my viewing of this film. Okay, I'm going to move on to the second example, which is The Silence of the Lambs. And perhaps I can just stop this for now. So, Demme. Demme's investment in psychoanalysis is thematized in The Silence of the Lambs as Dr. Hannibal Lecter. I assume you've seen the film, right? How many of you have seen the film? Okay, I'm not going to like summarize it a great deal. Thank you. Dr. Hannibal Lecter, who is, of course, Hannibal the Cannibal, is a former psychiatrist. His crime of cannibalism exposed, he has remained imprisoned in the mental ward for some years when the young FBI cadet, Clarice Starling, acting on orders from her boss, Jack Crawford, seeks him out to help her understand and ultimately identify the serial killer who is known as Buffalo Bill. The film thus puts forth a process of psychoanalysis as police procedural. In order to enlist Lecter's help, Clarice must win his favor by defending him to the extent that circumstances permit, and also share at this moment details of her traumatic childhood, quite as if she herself were in analysis rather than conducting an investigation. These exchanges produce the somewhat simplistic interpretation of Clarice's motivation for trying to save Buffalo Bill's next victim. As a young girl, Clarice has failed to rescue a lamb from being slaughtered, and now she identifies the victim with that lamb. Lecter tells Clarice to think about the mysterious killer the way Marc Aurelius would, that is, to distinguish between the essential and the incidental. He insists that both killing women and skinning them are incidental, and that the main thing which Buffalo Bill does is to covet, which means to envy. This theory eventually leads Clarice to Buffalo Bill because she assumes that the murderer must have been his first victim's neighbor or acquaintance, someone that he would have seen. And this conjecture proves correct. Clarice is also held by coincidence, and in the final confrontation with Buffalo Bill, she relies on the training that she has received as an FBI cadet, but she's also drawing on Lecter's and Crawford's teaching. So she has two mentors. Lecter's theory about coveting is a kind of simplified version of Girard's concept of mimetic desire. Instead of imitating someone the way that Girard imagines this, imitating someone who himself or herself is a desiring subject. So Girard basically says, we desire because we see other people desiring. We learn to desire by imitating those who desire. It's a little bit like Lacan with the triangle of love, okay? But in Lecter, in Hannibal Lecter's theory, this is simplified, okay? Instead of this kind of triangular situation, we just have one person looking at another person, and that person wants to become the person that they are looking at. Okay, that's the simplification that Lecter offers. According to Lecter, Buffalo Bill hates himself and wishes to become someone else. He turns to other people in a kind of fantasy that he might incorporate them and become like them. Okay, he kills other people so that, he kills women in fact, so that he would be able to literally wear their skin and kind of become as beautiful as those women are. So, Buffalo Bill embodies a mechanism which has more general applicability in Demme's film. Clarice is also trying to be like Crawford, and at other times trying to be like Lecter, as analytical as he is, as cool-headed, etc. Buffalo Bill merely takes the mimetic principle of incorporation, which I also call embodiment, to a literal extreme. Superficially, Lecter's cannibalism seems like another rendering of this principle, but Lecter is someone who already knows himself, which means that he does not consume others for the reason that Buffalo Bill kills women. Lecter simply likes eating people. Lecter and Buffalo Bill are opposed in this way, not just in their motivations, but also in their methods of embodiment or incorporation. Lecter eats, destroys, Buffalo Bill, of course, adorns himself and strives to assume the look of another. Clarice does not possess the kind of self-knowledge that is Lecter's. While Lecter has led her to the recognition that she identifies with the lamb, what he does not explicitly suggest is that the mechanism of this identification may be similar to Buffalo Bill covering what he sees. Clarice identifies with the slaughtered lamb because she has looked at it. Similarly, she hesitates to shoot Buffalo Bill when she finally finds him, getting both herself and his latest victim into a serious predicament that almost costs both of them their lives. It is as though she could not act without first looking, quite like Buffalo Bill. He does not simply shoot at Clarice either, but instead observes her with her night vision device, which allows Clarice to finally kill him in self-defense. But in any case, the scene illustrates the basic similarity that both confront Lecter's theory of coveting. They must look in order to know what they want to do, and even to know who they are. I hope that you perhaps remember this scene. It's a very striking scene, of course. It's a very, you know, suspenseful scene also, in which they are finding each other in the house where Clarice discovers Buffalo Bill. I think that this film is a paradoxical, even a perverse kind of narrative of education, wherein Buffalo Bill represents extreme and ultimately abject immaturity, and Lecter immense sophistication, and Clarice is kind of moving towards maturity and in some ways embraces it. The characters embodying the opposites of the opposites of maturity, immaturity and sophistication are somewhat similar. Both are criminals, but their motivations are also very different. Buffalo Bill is incorporating his victims in an imitative attempt to become like them, whereas Lecter simply kind of enjoys the pleasures of cannibalism. They're kind of like an adult pleasure. He understands that he's taking a risk and that's what he wants. And then we have Clarice moving, you know, kind of trying not to be like Buffalo Bill, but be a little bit like Lecter. Demme's film allegorizes this logic of embodiment with some striking visual images, implicitly making this logic seem suspect. In particular, there are many props in the science of the lab which suggest the importance of models, and also a certain disconnect between those models and the things that they represent. A crucial step in Clarice's investigation is her discovery of a storage locker, which Lecter helps her find, and which contains headless tailor's dummies alongside an actual human head preserved in a jar. As viewers, we are prompted to think that the head floating inside of the jar is another model until the shock of recognition hits us. Moreover, the head and the headless dummies seem to go together. Okay, we have headless dummies and a head, but of course, they don't really go together, suggesting that coveting, or embodiment based on imitation and incorporation, is somehow perhaps inadequate. In another scene, Clarice discovers a dress whose cut seems to be the basis for the way that Buffalo Bill cuts the skin of his victims. And this leads her, of course, to realize that, thanks to Lecter's lesson of, about coveting, that she is close to this to the previous home of Buffalo Bill. In the scene, she also discovers a dollhouse, which seems like a miniature representation of the house that she's searching. This is followed by two scenes in which a house is being entered. In one of these, it's a kind of mistake. Crawford and his FBI team think they are moving into the house, you know, where Buffalo Bill is hiding, but the house is just empty. In the other scene, it's also a mistake. Clarice walks in and she finds herself confronted with Buffalo Bill. So if we look at houses as embodiment, as a kind of metaphor of embodiment, what this sequence kind of tells us is that embodiment leads to something like a category mistake. The specific moment in the science of the lamps in which Clarice may be said to become an authentic agent also involves the dollhouse image. Okay, so the moment when she reaches maturity is also kind of related to images of house. This moment occurs during a scene in which the body of a Buffalo Bill's victim is examined. A funeral is in progress, which seems to remind Clarice of her father's funeral and perhaps allows her to complete her cycle of mourning. Immediately thereafter, Clarice takes initiative by asking a group of male police officers to vacate the room for the examination of the body. In doing so, she encounters or counteracts Crawford's sexist comment that he made earlier, for which she also berates him. During the examination, she makes the crucial discovery of a cocoon that has been placed inside of the woman's larynx. The cocoon represents transformation of the inert insect into a beautiful moth, but it also connotes incorporation because it has been placed inside the body and because the cocoon embodies the moth that it is to become. However, because the cocoon has been placed in the larynx, which is the place of articulation, it also connotes introjection, understood as a symbolic merchant of the impulse to incorporate through the fantasy or through some metaphoric embodiment such as cannibalism or the wearing of another skin. So I'm using here, this is a little bit sort of maybe technical, but I'm using here a set of terms that are very important in psychoanalysis and that come from an essay by two people called Abraham and Torok, Nicholas Abraham and Mary Torok, who have written an essay about how to distinguish between mourning and melancholia, and they talk about introjection versus incorporation. So introjection is when you can articulate your melancholia or your need to mourn. Incorporation is when you only resort to kind of symbolic gestures that suggest that you kind of like swallow the thing that you have lost, that you're missing. And so this moment in which the cocoon is found in the larynx, I think, kind of represents this moment where Clarice can move away from the model that Buffalo Bill is for her to the model where represented or that is Hannibal, because it's a moment in which incorporation is replaced by articulation. It's a moment in which she actually kind of finds her voice and she begins to command the situation. She is the one who makes the discovery. She's the one who tells her boss off for telling a sexist joke and so on. I hope that you can see that this is the kind of moment in which, you know, she is kind of like the butterfly emerging from that cocoon in a sense. And now in this moment, there is this very kind of interesting moment where, visually I think a very interesting moment, where she's putting, everyone is putting mental little bomb underneath their nostrils so as to kind of keep the smell out, the smell of the decaying body. And we have, in that moment, we literally have Clarice framed in a window, okay? We see her from outside through a window frame. And so her eyes are closed, but she's sort of like a portrait of herself almost, okay? So this is the moment in which something like embodiment is achieved finally, okay? And this is visually represented by Demme. Okay, so I'm going to actually try to show you this moment. It's a very brief moment. I'm showing it to you because I doubt that you would remember it otherwise. So bear with me. So she's sort of regained her voice, although I cannot. She's kind of asking men who are in the police force to leave the room so they can do the examination. It's a moment in which she kind of comes into into like complete self-control of who she is, I think. That's her boss. And she turns away to this window, and then we get a reverse shot in a moment.
And this is very strange. There is someone outside that window doing something, and he stops. The hand stops for no apparent reason. And what I think about this moment is that we are sort of shown this hand in order so that we might momentarily identify ourselves with that hand, because that hand is outside of the frame through which we see the portrait of Clarice. And then the hand stops, as though the person who's, you know, whose hand it is has kind of seen that Clarice is in the window. And kind of like, really, what I think this moment is doing is telling us, pay attention now. You know, pay attention. This is really important. So something, you know, someone stops what they're doing in order to look, and so we are in a position to identify with that someone, this kind of, you know, absent figure whose hand only we see, and so we are also told this is the key moment in the film. Okay, this is really what I'm trying to say to you. You know, this is the most important moment in the film. One other thing, maybe to say very quickly about the silence of the lamps is that it's kind of interesting to me also this kind of ugly smell that everyone is turning away from. And the smell is, in a sense, the smell of a female body. It's the smell of a decaying body also, of a dead body. And it's finally the smell of a kind of object body who was, you know, incorporated. The skin was stolen, right, by Buffalo Bill. That body is associated with this kind of object position that Buffalo Bill occupies, the position of someone who doesn't know who they are. Right, who is not embodied, who is not fully formed, who doesn't have something like personality or character. I hope that makes sense to you. That this kind of association. So what I'm trying to say is that the smell, in a sense, is kind of the opposite of the visual here too. Maybe this is why the substance. We don't know what the substance is. This kind of dark substance that is being, you know, kind of spread by this hand with a roller. This substance also maybe suggests something like shit, maybe, or something that would smell bad, right? So that's a very important opposition, I think, also in this moment. I'm just going to skip the rest of my talk about this film and move on to Philadelphia, because I think otherwise I'll just bore you to death. So Philadelphia. Seems like a very different film. This is Demme again. Because it is often regarded, and not without reason, as a milestone in kind of like, you know, gay liberation, positive presentation of the LGBT community, and so on. And many people have argued that this is a kind of atonement that Demme has offered after he was criticized for The Silence of the Lambs, for his very negative portrayal of women, maybe, but also especially of Buffalo Bill as a kind of transgender character. Okay, so the transgender community has kind of responded by saying this is really bad what you've done, and so the next thing that he does, and it's just a year later, he makes Philadelphia. 2 years later, he makes Philadelphia, and Philadelphia is this kind of very, very positive, you know, image that is offered. However, as you might probably guess, you know, some people have said, well, Philadelphia isn't actually completely positive, and some things that people have said about Philadelphia is that Philadelphia kind of desexualizes the gay relationship between the lawyer. Remember, this is a story about a lawyer who gets fired because he has AIDS, and this lawyer has a partner, and the story is played by Tom Hanks. The lawyer has a partner who is played by Antonio Banderas, whose name is Miguel, and the lawyer finally, you know, has to kind of like locate the lawyer who will take up his suit against the law firm that has fired him, and he cannot find one. He finally finds a black lawyer, an African American, who's played by Denzel Washington. And so this whole idea of the film is that, you know, this Philadelphia is the city of brotherly love, and this brotherly love is a kind of solidarity between minorities, in a sense. You know, the black lawyer helping the white gay man who has AIDS and so on. So this is kind of like, I'm just kind of simple lancing in this. Now, what people have said, of course, is that this overlooks the fact that there were, of course, gay lawyers who helped gay men and so on. So this film kind of obliterates the working of the LGBT, you know, community, and kind of leaves this white gay lawyer completely on his own, which seems kind of historically inaccurate. And other things, for example, that this film places so much importance on family life, on children, that it kind of desexualizes, you know, the life of those two gay men, Antonio
Miguel and the lawyer, you know, they are presented in this very chaste way and so on. So there's a number of ways in which this film was kind of criticized as not being such an important, you know, progressive picture as we might want to imagine that it was. I think that among those criticisms, there really is like one thing that is always left out. And this thing that is always left out, and I'm just going to play this scene and talk about it. I think it's better than my reading, probably. Is a kind of deathbed scene where we see the two lovers. And the family, the parents, and everyone else is here. The lawyer has just won his case against the law firm, and he's dying. And Antonio Banderas, the lover Miguel, is left alone in the room, and he does this little dance, as you will see in a minute. And now this is the same actor, of course, that is dancing with Pablo at the end of Love and Desire. So what I want to suggest is that this is one of several moments in this film where Demme kind of uses Love and Desire as a subtext by hiring or by, you know, by casting Antonio Banderas, of course, in the film, but also by using things that Antonio Banderas did in this other film by Almodóvar.
Now let me help you.
I'm ready.
So this is a moment in which, Miguel is told that his lover is about to die. But another way to read this, I think, is to say that this is a scene that kind of comes closest, paradoxically, to something like an erotic connection between the two of them, you know, one helping the other. And Tom Hanks is removing this mask as though he might want to maybe not just say something to Antonio, but also kiss him and so on. I mean, this film is very chaste, you know, it kind of really desexualizes those two men. But this is kind of, you know, as close as it comes, I think, to something like erotic representation. Moreover, there is, I think, a very strong intimation in this scene that what may be happening is that that the reason that this man dies that very night is not just because he was very sick, but also because he was very sick and his lover helped him to die. Okay, so that would actually be confirmed by a number of gay men's memoirs that I've been studying and reading for the book which Shea mentioned earlier, the book called Exposures, where there is a lot of evidence that people have actually done this for other people, and that they have kind of agreed ahead of time. And so when Tom Hanks says, "I'm ready," one of the ways in which to read this would be say, you know, this is the moment, this is when I want to die. And then we just have like a jump cut to a phone call that informs Denzel Washington, the black lawyer, that this guy has died. So we have this kind of, again, this kind of link between homosexuality and death, which was important in Law of Desire. And the question is, you know, how does it kind of appear in this film? I mean, it's very oblique, but how is it treated? And is it treated in a way that kind of echoes Law of Desire? So there are at least two other scenes that I want to briefly mention, which also suggest to me that Demme is paying homage to Almodóvar. One of those films is the scene of the wake after Andy has died. There is a wake, and in this wake there is an altar, and this altar is very much like the altar in the room where Antonio kills himself, and you know when the candles start to the other catches fire from the candles and so on. So we have a kind of allusion, I think, there to this altar that was built by Ada in Law of Desire. And the third moment is a scene, which I don't have here on the lecture, but it's a scene in which Tom Hanks is with Denzel Washington, and he sings, and it's after a party, and he sings, or lip syncs, and also explains the lyrics, translates the lyrics of an opera aria to Denzel Washington. And so it's a scene which kind of does the same thing which Antonio Banderas does in the Law of Desire film, in Law of Desire, where he lip syncs the tango, you know, to confess his love for Pablo. And in this case, what happens is that we have Tom Hanks performing a very similar gesture, where he translates the lyrics for his, you know, for his friend Denzel Washington, and the lyrics are about how, you know, love can bring misfortune, and so they are kind of apropos of the situation that that Andrew finds himself in, and it's also interesting that. That in this translation, we also hear the lyrics, and they're kind of playing in the background, performed by Maria Callas, and it's a recording. And very curiously, the lyrics are not complete, and so we don't get the complete lyrics on that recording by Callas, and we also don't get the full translation of the lyrics from Tom Hanks. But instead, we get his panic. He begins to pant. So, you know, he kind of is kind of like in the hospital scene where, you know, the mask fogs up and he has difficulty breathing. He again has difficulty breathing in this earlier scene, and so he's you know, he's trying to say something to Denzel Washington, but he also doesn't say everything. And what he omits specifically is I don't want to maybe summarize the entire opera. This is, you know, the Andrea Chenier, and the aria is like I said about how love brings misfortune. But what happens is that the character who sings this aria, whose name is Maddalena, you know, sings about the misfortune that she kind of brings to people by loving them. And one of those people is, of course, the poet Andrea Chenier, and this is translated by Tom Hanks. But what he leaves out, and what the recording leaves out also, is the next part where she talks about how her servant has become a prostitute in order to help her. Okay, so this whole kind of sexual connotation that is there in the lyrics is completely left out. And it's very interesting, again, that in this, in a very similar gesture to the one in the hospital, that I think Demme kind of you know, bowdlerizes or cleans up, you know, what he's doing, but also leaves certain traces to suggest that he's talking about the link between sexuality and death and homosexuality and death. And so he kind of very, I think, very consistently refers back to Almodóvar, both in the various visual moments where he pays homage and also in the kind of logic of the film. And finally, and I'll be done in a few minutes, the last film is called The Skin I Live In, and it's again by Almodóvar. And what I'm trying to say about this film is that Almodóvar is replying to Demme's kind of poetics of embodiment, of heroics of embodiment, specifically by paying homage to the first of the four films that I'm talking about, in other words, to The Silence, not the first, but the first film by Demme, which is The Silence of the Lambs. So maybe I'll just briefly read a part of this paper, because I think I'll be more efficient if I do this now. So the first thing to note about Almodóvar's The Skin I Live In is the use of the first person in the title. This brings forth the heroics of embodiment, and along with it, the attendant issues of looking and incorporating. Once again, Almodóvar is obviously interested in psychoanalytic choking. This is clear, for example, from his use of two-way mirrors and cameras to portray characters' identifications and desires as being relational. So, The Skin I Live In references a great many elements in Demme's The Silence of the Lambs, but it reverses some of those narrative developments and subject positions. For example, a bionic skin suit is made and is given to a character, given as a punishment, and also given alongside unwished for gender reassignment, reversing and perverting Demme's accouchement and his deployment of transgenderism as a category mistake in the case of Buffalo Bill. The film takes place, this kind of living takes place in two temporal planes. It is composed like a triptych. And the centerpiece is a retrospection. So in the first part of the film is the time present. We meet a guy who is, again, played by Antonio Banderas. His name is Dr. Robert Ledgar. Then his housekeeper, Maria, played by Maria Paredes, and she's Robert's mother, but he doesn't know this. And then there's this patient, whose name is Vera Cruz. And she's the only patient in the house. And we learn eventually that Vera Cruz has bionic skin, that Robert gave her this bionic skin. And then it's a kind of illegal experiment that he performed in doing so. They are in this very large, beautiful house in Toledo, Spain, and it's very private, so no one can really kind of know what is going on inside. But one day, when Robert is away, Maria receives her other son, whose name is Zerka. He shows up unexpectedly. He's wearing a carnival tiger's costume, okay? And this is again a kind of gesture that perhaps mocks, you know, Buffalo Bill's dressing up in those female skins. Zeka is actually Robert's stepbrother, though they don't know this about each other. And he has in the past wooed away Robert's wife, whose name was Gal. Zeka and Gal were in a car accident together, and her skin was badly burned, and then eventually she looked at her own reflection in the window pane, and she was so terrified of what she saw that she threw herself out the window and committed suicide in the windows, okay? So again, we have this idea of kind of being framed in the window, being portrayed, but in this case, it's the object, you know, image of skin that is badly damaged, which causes the suicide of this woman. Zeka comes into the house, he spots Vera, he kind of mistakes her for Gal, for the woman that he had in the past wooed, and he does this because, I mean, he kind of makes the mistake also because the artificial skin that Vera is wearing is kind of, and the face that she has been given is modeled on Gal. And he rapes her. And then Robert comes in and he actually shoots and kills Zeka. So then the retrospective piece, centerpiece of the film begins. And in this film, we are told the story of Robert and Gal. And then there's also a daughter whose name is Norma. And she's deeply affected by the mother's suicide. And eventually she also commits suicide. Norma is able to function socially only when she's medicated, and so in this very drugged state, she's at one point taken by Robert, her father, to a wedding party, and in this wedding party, she meets another man whose name is Vicente, okay? And this guy Vicente, of course, doesn't know that this girl is unstable, and so he begins to seduce her, to talk to her, to flirt with her. They go out into the garden, and it's a very interesting scene because it looks almost like a Garden of Eden. It's a very beautiful home with a very beautiful garden, and there's a party, and a lot of young people are essentially kind of in the bushes kissing or making out and so on and so forth. And they begin to do so too, because this girl, the daughter, Norma, she takes off her clothes, saying that she would much rather not wear anything. And of course, this guy Vicente is kind of becoming excited by this, and he goes along, and they end up, you know, making love. But in the middle of this scene when they're making love, Norma kind of awakens from this medicated state in a sense, or she has this kind of negative reaction to what's going on, and she tries to stop him, and what happens is Vicente, because she starts to cry out, and he puts his hand on her mouth, and she bites that hand, okay? She bites the hand. And it's a moment which is very striking for the reason that, on one hand, what I think is going on is that we have this kind of reference to cannibalism here and kind of throwback to Silence of the Lambs in this way. But in another way, what also happens is that this moment when she bites the hand is repeated. It's very strange because that usually doesn't happen in films. It's almost like, you know, sometimes you have like a repeat in slow motion of a short sequence. And here, it's not slow motion, but we have a repeat of the sequence when she bites her hand. Okay, literally, a repeat of the sequence when she bites his hand. And so, again, it's kind of like this in Demme, in The Silence of the Lambs, the hand moving and stopping and telling us, hey, look, this is very important. Here we have a very similar gesture, almost like a version of that gesture that is now created by Almodóvar as a kind of tribute, I think, to Demme, as a kind of sign, as a kind of allusion, you know, that is supposed to say, I'm actually doing something, you know, in relation to the previous film by Demme. In any case, what happens is that Vicente just runs away. He gets on his motorbike and rides away. Robert, who has come out of the house into the garden looking for his daughter, he sees her lying on the ground, and he sees this guy driving away. He kind of makes the connection, and the connection is in fact, you know, a mistake. But when he thinks that this guy has raped his daughter, he comes up to his daughter, and she thinks, because she's, you know, dragged out of her mind basically, she thinks that it's her father who hurt her. Okay, so she begins to grow afraid of her father. This is actually the reason why she will commit suicide, and he kind of grows estranged from her, and she too will throw herself out the window. But Robert decides to take his revenge on Vicente, on this guy, and he kidnaps Vicente. He puts him in a cellar. This is completely like Buffalo Bill, you know, entrapping his victims. Okay, so it's a very clear, I think, a very clear kind of repeat of the same gestures. There are lots of things that are similar. I don't want to you know, describe all of them, but for example, there is a dollhouse again, which is like the dollhouse in Demme's The Silence of the Lambs, and so on. So it's clear that Almodóvar is kind of playing with the idea of kind of revisiting that film. But what happens is that Robert first entraps this guy in order to, and does not feed him, starves him, in order to loosen his skin, okay? Again, very much like Buffalo Bill. And then he, instead of taking that skin away, he gives him a new artificial skin, okay? And this new artificial skin is one that will not burn. This goes back, of course, to the accident of the fire and his wife having, you know, Robert's wife having burned her face and so on. And it's bionic skin. But when he does this, he also turns him into a woman. And it's a kind of punishment. You know, he castrates the man who thinks has raped his daughter. But he turns him into a woman. And so we have, you know, Vicente becomes Vera. And at one point, Vicente kind of accepts, or seems to accept, that he is Vera. He begins to train yoga. He finds yoga as a way in which to learn to live in this new body that he has been given, the body of a woman with this very special skin. And so we, you know, we have all those things. And then at one point in the film, one of the surgeons that used to work with Robert and who actually operated on Vicente, and who was told at the time that Vicente is this very rich client who wants a sex change but wants that to do it discreetly, and Vicente is already anesthetized, he's unconscious when he's being operated by this other surgeon who assists Robert. This surgeon comes into the house with a newspaper where he has a photograph of Robert as a person who has been missing for several years. Now, by this point, Robert has kind of already come to an agreement with Vicente, who is now Vera, and Vera is no longer kind of imprisoned in the house, but is more at liberty to move around, and so Vera is not at home when this surgeon comes with the newspaper, but she does return from her shopping. And she confronts the surgeon, and she says, no, I am Vera. And so she kind of confirms, you know, Robert's lie, that she was a very, you know, rich client who wanted this surgery, really. Okay, and so they seem to kind of fall in love, Robert and Vera. However, she comes down the stairs that night, and the reason that she actually does this is to get something from her handbag, but she looks at the picture in the paper and sees herself as Vicente and is reminded, you know, by this picture that she was Vicente, I guess. She finds a handgun, a gun in the drawer of Robert's bureau, and she goes up to his bedroom. He completely expects that what they're about to do is have sex, but she actually shoots him dead. Okay, then also shoots the mother, who's the housekeeper. The next morning, and this is how it ends, Vera goes back to a shop where he was an assistant to his mother. Okay, so Vera, when he was Vicente, was a shop assistant and in a shop that was a second-hand clothes shop run by his mother.
And he goes back and he meets his mother, and he also meets the other shop assistant, who is a lesbian woman called Christina. And I need to tell you this because it's important, I think, to understand the ending. Christina is a lesbian woman who works in the shop, and before Vicente goes to the wedding reception where he meets Norma and all his trouble begins, he tells Christina, why don't you go to the party with me, and why don't you wear this very beautiful dress? And Christina says, no, I don't want to do that because I'm not interested in men. And he says, you're making a mistake. This is very much like lecture saying Buffalo Bill is making a mistake about being transgender. And so she says, you mean a mistake because I don't like guys? And he says something like, no, because you don't like me. And so it's a kind of innocent flirtation, okay? Now, when he goes back to the shop at the end of the film, he is wearing that same dress, okay? He has just bought that dress the day before, and he's wearing the same dress in order so that he can tell the anecdote to Christina again and kind of show this as evidence that he's really, you know, really Vicente, because Christina and Vicente were the only people who knew about this, you know, about this flirtation. So it's a very kind of interesting ending, because what we have is, you know, is this woman who is, you know, Vera, standing in front of those people in the dress and saying, I'm Vicente. This is how the film ends. It's kind of all about, you know, about identity and a kind of necessity for misrecognition, for a kind of, you know, for a kind of mistake about, you know, in reading who that person is. But finally, I just want to maybe show you one short sequence, and that will really be the end, from that film. And it's the sequence of the flirtation, and there's a reason why I would like to show it to you, which I hope to explain. The Skin I Live In, this is the last film by Almodóvar, or the last novel studied by Almodóvar, and just make sure I get the right... the right moment. So here is the shop, okay? Here is the clothes shop, and we have some people shopping here. I think it just takes time to kind of catch up with me. Okay, I'll just need to describe this to you. Okay, so after Vicente and Christina had this exchange about the dress, which of course later becomes really important, here it is, okay. The mother appears
in the window,
and she says, just leave Christina alone, okay? She doesn't really need to say this because he's not, you know, molesting her in any way. But she's kind of like a god who appears in this Garden of Eden. And it's a scene which kind of goes back to this scene, or which kind of anticipates, rather, the scene in which we will see this kind of Garden of Eden-like seduction with Vicente seeming to rape Norma, and Norma seeming to want to seduce Vicente, and so on. But what I want to say is that I think this moment where we see the mother of Vicente appearing in this window with kind of like little toys and people sitting here is very much like this idea of the dollhouse and the framing of the window that we also get in Demme. Okay, this moment is a kind of clear, again, a kind of clear throwback, I think, to that earlier moment. So I'm just going to actually stop in a minute, but my point is that what we have, I think what happened in this last film by Almodóvar, In the Skin I Live In, is a kind of attempt to revisit the silence of the lambs and kind of change this whole logic of this Bildung Roman, of this Bildung narrative, of this narrative of education, where we have this theory of lecture about coveting, and we have Clarice moving, you know, from this position where she needs to covet, just like Buffalo Bill, who is so abjectly immature and kind of trying to become as mature as her boss and as mature as lecturer. What we have in The Skin I Live In is a kind of deliberate upsetting of this logic of maturation, of this logic that one, you know, develops into a full-fledged personality. Instead, what we have is just a series of complete mistakes. And the scene in the Garden of Eden, as I called it, and also the scene, which is somewhat like, you know, the, another Garden of Eden version, is I think deliberately, you know, mocking the ideas and also the visual props which are deployed by Demme. Okay, so this is really my point, I guess, that they're really doing two things that are very much opposed. I think that Demme kind of has an intelligent reading of Almodóvar. He understands that Almodóvar both uses and opposes this link between homosexuality and death, for example, and he, in a sense, plays with that idea in The Silence of the Lambs. But then Almodóvar replies to this by looking at the earlier film, by the film, The Silence of the Lambs, and he kind of really, I think, you know, deconstructs or upsets or questions the logic of that film in terms of this narrative of education, this narrative of maturity. Okay, so that's really what I, you know, what I'm trying to say, I guess, in the briefest possible, you know, summary that I hope helps you to get the, you know, too long talk that I just offer. Thank you. So if you have any questions, I can like to see one of those films or part of it now.
Maybe I will ask a question about chronology, because the first three movies are basically close to each other in terms of time of their making, and The Skin That I Live In has been made 10 or 15 years later. Do you think that this time difference is significant in terms of the portrayal of gender identities or sexuality, homosexuality?
Sure. Yeah, that's a good point. Yes, I think that, you know, it's kind of like third wave feminism or something, you know, that this kind of playfulness that is very much in evidence in The Skin I Live In is a sign of the times. In other words, I don't want to say, I mean, Almodóvar has always played with, you know, very skillfully played with kind of combining, emotionally loaded, you know, images and narratives, combining those with humor. I mean, he was very good at kind of combining melodrama and humor, for example. So I think that this kind of tonality isn't completely new in Almodóvar, but I think that the extent to which he relies on something like science fiction that is medical in its tendency or tone, you know, that is probably something that would have been less available, you know, 10 years previously. I mean, yeah. Yeah, this, I mean, also this film, I mean, you know, I kind of, like I said, I've been working on this paper for a long time. Actually, I began working on it before this last film was made. And I think that you know, I kind of suspect my own narrative about this film, because my own narrative about this film is, I mean, I was suspicious of my own narrative about this film, because my own narrative about this film is essentially that it's a kind of deconstruction, that it's a kind of upsetting, as I said, you know, of what happens in The Silence of the Lambs. And it's in a kind of upsetting of what I'm calling the heroics of the poetics of embodiment. But I wonder if that's the whole story. And I mean, I don't know that I can see, you know, beyond that one insight. And maybe, again, this is because the film is relatively new, and so one doesn't have the kind of, you know, intellectual distance that may come from, you know, in the case of an older film.
And there's also the horror legacy of the horror genre and how it treats technology and the relationship between technology and body. And I think that this is really present in this Skin That I Live In, this genre underpinning of the movie.
Yeah, sure. I mean, you're right. I mean, of course, it's a kind of Frankenstein, you know, film in a sense.
But I think that this connection between the movies is very interesting. Kind of when it's described, it kind of becomes obvious, but it was like hidden in the open.
Yeah, one of my difficulties is that I don't know of any kind of extra diegetic, you know, or extra textual evidence for this theory. So, you know, I kind of wonder if I ask Demme or Almodóvar, if they might actually, you know, if I got them to talk to them, if they might actually deny that I have any, you know, real point here. That's another question.
I was going to ask you. Did any of them, so they never acknowledged?
No, not to my knowledge. No one has asked this question.
This guy also.
I mean, I have never, you know, I have never read any comparisons between those films, between Demme and Almodóvar. And it seems to me, I mean, it's partly intuitive, but partly I think also, you know, based in kind of like textual evidence, that it's clearly there, this dialogue. But no, I mean, I don't know that they've ever talked about it, and I don't know that this has been discussed by others. Yeah, well, thank you so much for your patience. You were really very nice not to walk out halfway through this. So, if there's no other questions, I think we should probably call it quits.